his achievements and his work. So we would like to invite you on a journey through his exciting life within 40 minutes. Before we start, I would like to thank our English friend, Sarah Beesgood, for her assistance. She's going to read the introductory texts. Thank you very much. I also would like to thank the curators of the Kingston Museum, Charlotte Samuels and Sir Young Kim, who invited us to perform our show here. Thank you very much. Now, please enjoy the reading, the guitar music, and this camera, which provides some surprises for you, I hope, not for us. I hope it will work. Please enjoy the hovering horse. Thank you.
From Kingston to San Francisco. On April the 9th, 1830, a son was born to the merchant John Mugridge and his wife Susanna in the English village of Kingston upon Thames. His parents call him Edward James. He changes his name several times in his life, from Mugridge to Mygridge, and later to Mybridge. He also changes the spelling of his first name to recall the English king Edward, to whom a monument was built in his hometown.
Kingston was a rather quiet place at that time, and the only variety brought the coaches which rumbled through our village a few times a day. When I was 13, my father died. My mother and my elder brother John took care of us, but 4 years later, John also died, and now it was my turn to help my mother in business. It was going really well, but somehow I did not want to be a grain trader for my whole life. I wanted to make something out of myself. And when the World Exhibition came to London in 1851, and I walked through this gigantic crystal palace and saw photos and inventions from all over the world, I knew where I wanted to go, to America. When I said goodbye to my grandma, she gave me a few gold coins and said, "You'll need the money, my boy." But I did not accept it. Grandma, I said to her, "I'm gonna make it. If not, you will never know." So I took the ship to New York, where I spent a while in the book trade. One day I met the photographer Silas Wright Selig in New York, and I watched fascinatingly how he made daguerreotypes on a polished metal surface. Selig, however, wanted to go to California. He thought he could earn much more money than anywhere else, owing to the gold rush. Then he grabbed his suitcase and set off. The thought appealed to me to follow him and to make my fortune in California. But how could I get there? Traveling across the country with a carriage and perhaps being massacred by Indians? Or should I better take the ship down to Panama and cross the isthmus by foot? There was no channel yet. This lasted only a week, but you had to accept to be infected with malaria or cholera in the jungle. I did not want that either. That is why I decided to travel around South America, which took a long time but seemed to be the safest alternative. In 1855, when I was 25 years old, I finally arrived in San Francisco.
The accident with the stagecoach. Meanwhile, San Francisco has 35,000 inhabitants, and the city is still growing quickly. People need something to eat, clothes, a roof over their heads, and much more. It is golden times for entrepreneurs of all kinds. Mybridge opens a bookshop and earns good money, not only with books, but also with photographs from all over the world. The demand is huge and the business is flourishing, but he soon has new plans.
I wanted to see more of this country, of its unspoiled and magnificent nature. The wilderness attracted me magically. But when I was on the road with the coach, something terrible happened. We drove down a steep slope and suddenly the brakes failed. The carriage came off the road, rammed a tree and turned over. A fellow traveler was immediately dead. We others were all seriously injured. I was still trying to tear open the deck to somehow get out of this damn carriage. Then I lost consciousness. I did not return until I woke up in a strange bed in a strange place. I had a big wound on my head and saw everything in double vision. Mad headaches tormented me and I could not smell or taste anything. The symptoms lasted for 3 months. I did not want to go back to California and struggled through to New York. There I took a ship and went straight back to England, to my mother.
Yosemite. In the spring of 1861, Mybridge once again goes to New York to sue the post company at an American court. But instead of the required $10,000 of compensation, he receives only $2,500. He returns back to London to avoid the American Civil War, which had begun in April of the same year. 5 years later, in 1866, Mybridge returns to San Francisco and devotes himself to photography.
I've been interested in the subject for years. I've experimented a lot and learned a lot. However, wherever you are forced to drag the whole dark room, a tent, and the necessary chemicals. Again and again, dust, insects, and sweat is dripping on the plates, and you are dazed by the ether vapor. So I loaded all my equipment on mules and made my way to the Yosemite Valley, 150 miles from San Francisco. It went over stony paths, steeply up and down again through incised valleys, through tearing watercourses and through rocky terrain. Often enough, I had to make a way through the wilderness, through thickets and rubble, to find new perspectives and photo spots. Some weeks later, I returned to San Francisco, tired and exhausted. But the efforts had paid off. I had made some spectacular landscape photos, which I could now reproduce and sell. The public was enthusiastic because they had never seen such pictures. Towering mountains, hundreds of meters of falling water, shrouded by sparkling steam. All appeared in a brilliant light, bright and lively, a true reflection of nature. Only the colors are still missing in the picture.
Flora, Mybridge is self-employed in San Francisco as a photographer and calls his company Helios, the Flying Studio. He drives with his equipment in a two-wheeled cart, which is strung with a horse. His great landscape images also bring him public commissions. The American government commissions him, amongst other things, to photograph the lighthouses on the Pacific coast. In his work, he meets a young woman, Flora Shallcross Stone.
I had a shop in the entrance area at Woodward's Gardens, the largest amusement park in San Francisco. There I sold, amongst other things, stereo images, which I recorded with two cameras eye distance apart. When viewed with a stereoscope, they appear spatially. Of course, I also took pictures in the park, and I took a photograph of Flora one day, together with a stuffed tiger. She was pretty, a bit chubby, and still very young, just 20 years old. She had already married at 16, but was divorced again. Apparently she liked me, although I was almost twice her age. She did not mind, looked at me in love, and came to me again and again. I asked her if she wanted to marry me, and she said, yes. course, I still had a lot to do and was constantly on the road with my flying studio. Flora usually stayed at home during this time and was bored. I suggested to her that she went to the theater and enjoy herself. At one performance, she met the critic Harry Larkins. He always had cheap theater tickets and he invited her to visit the shows together with him. At first I did not mind that they met, but when Flora did not come home for a whole night, I suspected something. I talked to Harry Larkins and made it clear to him what I would do if he would take away my wife. Flora became pregnant and I came home from a business trip one day after my child's birth. I called my son Floredo Helios, a combination of the name of my wife and my pseudonym. One day, I found a photo in the bedroom that showed my newborn son. On the back and the handwriting of my wife, I read the words, "Little Harry." I was completely stunned. Floredo was not my son, but the child of Harry Larkins. I had warned him, and although he had already left the city, I tracked him down and shot a bullet into his chest.
Process. Larkins is dead. Muybridge is immediately arrested, put under a murder prosecution and imprisoned. A process is scheduled. His defence lawyer is trying feverishly to gather evidence for mental illness of his client. A man balancing on an overhanging boulder at a height of 1,500 meters cannot be normal. A sick man may not be hung, but Muybridge himself rejects this argument. He knows exactly what he was doing when he shot Larkins.
I spent terrible weeks and months in prison, and still worse, the trial in court. Everything seemed lost to me when Pendergast, my lawyer, held the final plea. His speech overwhelmed me that I almost collapsed and could no longer stand on my feet. He appealed to the jury's sense of honor and asked if any honest man would not have done the same in my situation, whether he had not reacted to the adultery as I did. Even though self-adjudication is not legal, it can be legitimate in individual cases to restore the honor of a man. The audience ended this speech with frenetic applause, and the jury withdrew to the consultation. The verdict was not guilty. It took me a few weeks before I could think again. I had only one need, to leave Flora and this child, which was not my own. An order from the Pacific Postship Company came to me just right. I should take a photo series of Panama and Guatemala to promote tourism and attract potential investors. In addition, I should document the cultivation and shipping of coffee, since the company had the monopoly on it. So I went to Central America in 1875, where I stayed for 6 months. and took hundreds of photographs. These are the ruins of El Carmen in Antigua, a decayed church from the Spanish colonial period.
Panorama. Back in San Francisco, my bridge is making new city views. He also photographs the mansions of wealthy Americans. In this way, he gets acquainted to the railroad baron and millionaire Leland Stanford, who will have great influence on the work of my bridge. In the meantime, he prepares an overall panorama of San Francisco, which he takes from the tower of a house on the California Street Hill.
The house of Mark Hopkins had a very exceptional location on the hill. From there, you had a spectacular view of the city. In June 1878, I dragged all my equipment up onto the tower. On the platform, I marked very precisely the individual positions of the camera because I wanted to create a complete panorama. The single images should fit exactly, but not overlap. At 11 o'clock in the morning, I began recording. My assistant and I were busy preparing the 51 to 61 centimeter glass plates, moved them carefully into the camera, exposed and developed them immediately afterwards. What can one see on this panorama? What incredible details. One looks at a city where 250,000 people live, seeing every church, recognizing every house. You can see the high wall which two quarreling neighbors have erected between their houses. You can see the tracks of the tram, the ships in the port, and further out, Alcatraz Island. You can see the city as it looked on a sunny day in June 1878, 28 years before the disastrous earthquake destroyed the city. But you don't see any people. The exposure time was too long.
Thank you.
hovering horse. Muybridge had recognised the problem long ago. If you want to photograph moving people or animals, you have to reconstruct the shutters of the cameras and, above all, increase the light sensitivity of the plates. For several years, he works at shorter exposure times. Leyland Stanford, who is also a passionate horse rider, has a very special challenge for him. Muybridge is supposed to photograph a galloping horse to make the single movement phases visible.
Stanford wants to know whether a horse lifts all four hooves from the ground at the same time in a certain movement phase. He thinks so and has bet a few thousand dollars. I should now give him the proof, but how? Even if I had a camera with an extremely short exposure time, let's say a thousandth of a second, it would be pure coincidence to catch the phase on the picture in which the horse hovers. You might have not only one camera, but 10 or 20, what do I know? Stanford says I should not worry. He pays for it, he pays for all of this. He even hired a few engineers to help me. So we went to Palo Alto, where Stanford had his top farm. There we built a camera shelter in which 12, and later even 24 cameras were placed next to each other. I imagined that the horse galloped along, tearing the threads which were spanned across the track, and thus successively releasing the shutters of the cameras. So it would be possible to keep all the movement phases. If only it would work. Once the shutters did not work, all the images were out of focus. I do not know how often we had to repeat the recordings. It was too stupid. After all that, we got it. Stanford was absolutely enthusiastic when he saw the pictures, and he had been right. The horse lifted all four hooves simultaneously from the ground in one movement phase. You could see it clearly. My job was done, but I still had another idea. I built a zoopraxis scope with which I could present the whole series of photos like a film. I still remember when Stanford invited his friends to show them this apparatus. We extinguished the lights in the room where we were sitting. Then on the white surface of the wall appeared a picture, a moving picture, a galloping horse. Everyone was completely surprised. They had never seen anything like that.
motion sequences. After Muybridge was concerned with horses for a long time, he begins to photograph other animals and people. Because triggering the shutters with the torn threads does not work, he builds an electrical timer, which automatically triggers the shutters of the cameras one after the other.
So he made hundreds and thousands of photos. Among these, there is a running man. Girl who gives flowers to her mother. I made several lecture journeys through America, England, France, Germany, and Italy. Everywhere, people were fascinated to watch my pictures and movies. I proved that artists of all time had misrepresented the movement of horses. In May 1897, I finally returned to England and settled down in my birthplace, Kingston upon Thames.
Muybridge left us fascinating series and photos of a bygone era. They show us the faces and bodies of people who showed themselves more than 100 years ago, often even naked. They walk and move, looking serious or amused at the camera. Muybridge documents only everyday things, but in a form that still fascinates us today. To this extent and accuracy, there was never anything comparable. However, the photos show something else. They do not only revive the past, but also remind us of the transience of life. People appear like a shadow on a piece of photographic paper, fleeting and void. On May the 8th, 1904, Edward Muybridge dies at the age of 74. Thank you.